Wednesday, July 15, 2015. It is now 6:33 p.m. for the record. First thing we'll have is a roll call from our city manager, please.
Councilmember Haroff.
Here.
Councilmember Morrison.
Here.
Councilmember Hilmer.
Here.
Vice Mayor Way.
Here.
Mayor Chu.
Here. All right. Please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, before we start any of our regular agenda items and business items, what we'd like to do tonight is to formally recognize Chief Robert Bob Sinnott, our longtime police chief and, fire chief. I'm looking at Jim here and thinking police chief and, well, it should be fire chief. We all know that. But we try and get our proclamations onto an 8.5 by 11, and Bob has been in service here so long in Larkspur that I'm going to need to put on a pair of glasses to read this, because there's a lot here, and it's kind of in small print. But I'm going to read this into the record, and you know, council as well as members of the public can also acknowledge and recognize, you know, your service. We also have former Mayor John Lubomirsky here with a proclamation from Assemblyman Mark Levine's office. So this is a proclamation of the City of Larkspur in recognition of Fire Chief Bob Sinnott on the occasion of his retirement from the Larkspur Fire Department. Whereas 8 years after the Sinnott family moved to Larkspur in 1968, the Larkspur Fire Department was forever changed when a Redwood High guidance counselor encouraged the young Robert Bob Sinnott to see if the department offered work experience opportunities through a cadet program. Whereas after first being told that there was not a program, the persistent 15-year-old Bob was made the department's first and only cadet at the age of 15 in 1976, and then appointed a volunteer firefighter when he turned 16 later in the year. Whereas Bob's parents, perhaps eager to get him out of the house, allowed him to move into the Greenbrae Fire Station and become a resident volunteer firefighter at the age of 17. Whereas Bob was hired as a full-time firefighter in 1980 and filled various roles until his promotion to chief in 1993. Whereas for the last 20 years, Bob has served as the executive officer of the Ross Valley Paramedic Authority, one of the longest running and most successful joint powers authorities, multi-agency partnerships in Marin County. Whereas in the Larkspur tradition, Bob has been a man to wear many hats, serving as deputy city manager for 18 years, bearing the mantle of building official and interim library director at different times, and representing the city on boards such as entities as the Central Marin Sanitation Agency and the Marin Emergency Radio Authority. Whereas in 1992, Bob was named Larkspur's Business Citizen of the Year by the Chamber of Commerce. Whereas it was Larkspur that Bob met the love of his life, Mary Beth, and together have raised their two sons, Sean and Kevin, and their daughter, Kaylee, over the course of their 29 years and still counting of marriage. Whereas Bob's friends in the Central Marin Police Authority want it memorialized that Bob's exemplary public service as a firefighter appears to have inspired both Sean and Kevin to pursue careers in law enforcement. And whereas Bob Sinnott's career and service to Larkspur can be summed up in four words: he made a difference. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed by the Larkspur City Council that July 15, 2015 is Bob Sinnott Day in the City of Larkspur in recognition for his years of service to our community and to the County of Marin. Yeah, let me sign this.
Lucky you, Larry.
Perfect.
Thank you.
No one deserves it.
Okay, at this point, I'd like to invite former Larkspur Mayor Joan Lundstrom, Lubomirsky. I am just all over the place tonight.
The other Joan L., who also lives on Francis Avenue, but that's okay. I think I can reset my glasses. Robert B. Sinnott presented an appreciation for his dedication to the citizens of Larkspur, spanning almost 40 years, in posts including firefighter, EMT, building inspector, fire marshal, executive officer of the Ross Valley Paramedic Authority, deputy city manager, and fire chief, exemplifying a model of distinguished and honorable public service and devotion to ensuring the safety of the residents and the lands of his beautiful city.
Thank you very much. Just a brief thank you, because it's an emotional time for me, and it's been a dream for me to work for the city of Larkspur. I've worked with the most amazing people, the firefighters, the Larkspur city staff. We've had amazing city managers, the management team. It has been a dream that I've been able to live. So I just want to say thank you very much. Thank you.
Well, Bob was a neighbor of mine. He lived right across the street from me, over off of Magnolia. I'm just around the corner of Alexander. I can at least attribute him getting me to here to some degree, because Bob knew of my disaster planning background. And at one point, dozen or more years ago, when we were back at the Twin Cities Co-op, you know, he just asked me if I'd be willing to help out on a committee dealing with, public safety and disaster preparedness stuff. And as a result of that, I think, we were the first NERT class in the days when it was called NERT rather than CERT now. So, it's always one of those things, one thing leads to another. You know, somebody's always asking you back to do some public service, and, you know, now I'm sitting up here. But, you know, the but there is, there's a guy who exemplifies Larkspur. There isn't anybody you can walk up to on the street seemingly and not know who the Sinnott family is. You know, they're here, they've been here forever. They're a real fixture in the community. We have now another generation of public servants. Glad to see, you know, Sean and Kevin. I saw them out in uniform, you know, at one point earlier. So really like to thank you for your years of service here. I know you're not going anywhere as a Larkspur resident, but best wishes to you in San Rafael. It's, you know, like Joe Montana, I guess he didn't retire as a 49er, but, you know, we certainly appreciate everything you've done for this city.
Thanks. I am touched beyond belief. And Larkspur will always be part of my fabric, and I think you all know that. So thank you.
Thank you. Right. Any other council members like to make a comment?
Ex-chief, we know where you live.
Ex-chief happens to live in my neighborhood now, and it's really fun to watch you drive down the street or even walk down the street. And Bob, your huge smile and your big hello, it's contagious. Anyway, thank you for all you do.
Okay, well, at this point, you know, thank you again, Bob, for coming tonight. Don't want to hold you up unless you want to stay here and listen to other things we have on our agenda tonight.
I appreciate it. I'll see you all very soon.
Yes,
yeah. Absolutely. Still take you up on that lunch, though, in San Rafael.
Thanks.
Thank you. Okay. The next item on our agenda tonight is the approval of the consent calendar. What we're going to do is we're going to put on the consent calendar all the items except for item 3.8, which is a resolution 6515 to authorize the retainer for the Grove Consultants for the town hall meetings associated with the community facility parcel project. So I'm going to put that at the beginning of the business items, and What I'll take right now is that if no member of the public or the council would like to see other items on the consent calendar removed for discussion or questions, I'll take a motion to approve that.
I'll move the adoption of the consent calendar as modified.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
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 Okay, thank you. Right, next item on our agenda is the oral report from our city manager, Dan Swartz.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. First off, I wanted to let the council know that we're going to ask for agenda item 8.3 on the business item calendar, which is an amendment to the municipal code. That wasn't agendized correctly, so we'll ask that you not take that up tonight, and we'll bring it back in August for you. We do actually have some surplus property we need to dispose of, so we're going to follow the parameters of what's in the policy that you see in the item. But we'll bring it for formal adoption in August when we have it on the agenda correctly. So with that, first, I always like to come to you in the second meeting in July and say with great pleasure that once again, our commendations to the Department of Public Works, the Central Marin Police Authority, and the Fire Department for pulling off a 4th of July parade that had no major incidents. And actually no minor incidents, so that's a really good year. Really appreciate that. It was a little more complicated, as you know, this year because of the work going on at the Redwood High School parking lot. So those who were in the parade, I know a few of you participated in the parade, it was just a teeny bit longer this year. But that did add some logistics for us on our end, and that all went off without a problem. So thank you to all the staff who were involved. I also really want to thank the Department of Public Works because on the evening before the parade, the caution tape came down on the new playground at Dolliver Park, and it was in heavy use by children on July 4th who were attending the parade and or visiting folks in that area. And if you haven't gone by to see it, I think they did a wonderful job. You may recall that playground was part of our Measure A campaign to upgrade our mini parks, and it was also the product of then our brand new junior engineer Alvin Tan going out and being in the park and asking folks what they wanted to see in a new playground structure. I think it was partly a joke and partly true. We kind of had him out there with an A-frame sign at one point, a sandwich board sign on him saying, "Please come talk to me," and had a chance for people to look at the different options essentially in the catalog and tell us what do you like and not like? So thank you to getting that open to the staff before July 4. I'm only going to report on one other item tonight, and it kind of follows on the presentation we just did, and that's that I wanted to make sure the council and the public are all aware, as our staff's now well aware, that I am actively talking with my counterpart, Dave Bracken, in Corte Madera about the fact that our fire chief retired and what options there are for our communities to work together. As many folks know, their fire chiefs announced his retirement later this fall. So the timing for our two communities to talk actively about something we've talked on and off about for years is ripe, and we are having those discussions, as are, I anticipate, they will come through council subcommittee and then eventually the council at some point. So it's a very interesting and exciting time and opportunity with respect to fire service in our two communities. And I'll just make a note, the council will be dark for August 5th. You won't hold your regularly scheduled meeting. We've had that discussion before, and you typically have made one meeting dark for summer break, and that'll be the August 5 date. Turn it back to you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, thank you. Does anyone have any questions or other things they'd like to ask this city manager?
I do.
Yes.
Dan,
please.
Can you just let the public know what's happening at the Redwood parking lot? I just learned about it yesterday, so I thought maybe they'd
Well, the school district is installing carports that have solar on top of them. So that's part of an initiative that's actually been happening at high schools in other parts of the state too. I understand there's been some funding to help with that, so it's very exciting. It will certainly change the look though when it's done, because you're going to see these significant solar panels out, but they're going to generate a lot of power for the district.
Thank you.
Okay, Kevin?
Just a quick question, or actually a comment to echo your comments about how great the parade was. It was very well organized. It was long, but there were a lot of participants, including some of us. And it was just a ton of fun, and I think everyone in the community really enjoyed it and appreciated the public safety services that were provided to us to make it run smoothly and safely. So I just wanted to echo those comments and congratulate our police force and our fire department for making that a great day. And then just a question on the status, and maybe this is more for Mary Grace, I don't know. Just on the status of the discussions that we've been having, speaking at Court Madera on the Tamil Vista project with the application that was submitted and where we might stand with that.
So you're referring to, we've been working together with Court Madera, and they're actually in serve as applicants on a proposal to seek grant funding for some improvements on Warnham in and around the freeway. That application's moved forward, and our two cities are collaborating to make sure that if we get that grant money, we can realize these improvements as soon as possible. I suspect that's probably something we can distribute some of that information to folks who are interested about what we've proposed in the grant application. And then right now, TAM, the Transportation Authority of Marin, is working with all the jurisdictions to prepare the package of ideas and concepts and proposals throughout the whole county that'll go to MTC for the next round of RTP funding. So we've sort of, as a staff, had to move our energies, as has Court Madera, to complying with everything. TAM's going to need to move that process forward. I think after that's done, we can turn our energies back to our local discussion.
Okay, fair enough. Thank you. Appreciate that.
Okay. Next, we have reports and comments by our council members. Does anyone have anything they'd like to report out on?
I do.
Yes, please.
Just a bit of gratitude and thanks. Mary Grace, our Public Works Director, came to Hillview last Tuesday and last night to discuss about the Greenspan development. That's the dirt between Dartmouth and Bonaire Road. And she brought out the landscape architect for both of those meetings, a nice turnout for both of those evenings. And it was real informative, and she was a great listener. You listened to what the neighbors wanted, and it seems like it's gonna be an incredible project and beautiful when it's all said and done. So thank you for that. I also appreciate the billboards you're putting up about the transparency about the Bonnie replacement, what's happening there. That's so important to get that out to the public. Great job on that. And I think our website, Dan, is really well updated. So it's anybody who wants to know what's going on in Larkspur, just go to our website and you'll find out all the information. So thanks for all that.
Okay, yes.
Just real quick, I just want to mention, kind of on my own more than anything else, I attended the last week's meeting of the Marin Municipal Water District, where, among other things, there was consideration of a suspension for a period of time of the use of glyphosate as an herbicide in Marin Municipal Water District lands. And the meeting, particularly with respect to that issue, was extremely well attended. That issue has garnered a lot of public attention. It's always been a source of pride to me, which I repeat to people, that chemical is not being used by the city of Larkspur. We've talked about that before. And I think that gives us an opportunity to set an example within the community. But it was gratifying and well-received that the Water District did vote to suspend the use of glyphosate within the Water District lands, at least during the pendency of the finalization of their management plan and the preparation of an environmental impact report to support that. So it's technically a temporary suspension of the use of that chemical. They have not been using that chemical, and they made it very clear that glyphosate has not been used in Water District lands historically, at least for the last 10 years, which I think is about the only period of time where it could have been used, and that will stay in place at least for the time being. So I just wanted to report on that.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, no. Okay, just a couple quick items. One of them was another one of those fun things today. When we did the dedication of the Bonaire pedestrian bridge behind the Bonaire Center up to the neighborhood on the other side of the creek a couple weeks ago, one of the things that Andrea Schultz and the Greenway property asked me about was whether the plaque on the old Twin Cities Police Station was still around. And it was a plaque that had her grandfather's name on it because he was the one who contributed $35,000 towards the building of the first police station. In those days, that was a lot. I mean, I think that was probably more than half the cost of it. But, well, it was a temporary building, too. But, you know, we had Chief Cusimano look around, you know, after, you know, the new building has been in. We didn't have any clue whether it was going to be still available if someone threw it out, and we actually found it. And Chief went out, refurbished the whole thing because it had been sitting outdoors for 40 years, you know, redid the whole surface of it. It was a bronze plaque. And today we went over there and presented it to her, and it was quite emotional for her to get that back, and she really appreciated and wanted to thank the council and police authority for getting that to her. One of the things we did get was a tour, and they have a whole two full walls of pictures going back 50, 60 years. And basically, it's like a pictorial history of Greenbrae. So if anybody ever gets a chance to go over there, you know, make an appointment with Greenbrae Management, you know, you can see all that stuff from basically empty lots to what we see now today. So the other item is just for staff as well as council. Corte Madera is considering right now a ban on leaf blowers. And even prior to that, I've been getting emails asking if Larkspur would do the same thing. One of the issues that I've written about in the past is that if people are just interested in banning leaf blowers because of the noise, gasoline leaf blowers already exceed our noise ordinance. So that's just an enforcement thing. But if they're talking about the environmental aspects of you know, having leaf blowers in general because of all the dust and particulate matter, then that may be a separate issue. But that's just kind of an FYI that because of the attention that Corte Madera is giving it, it's likely that it will, you know, our own residents may be asking for the same thing.
Okay, Larry, before yes. we go on, could I, there's one thing I forgot to ask the city manager, if maybe you could comment. One of the things that I've been getting questions about and noticed myself, speaking of Bon Air, are the union protests that are going on at the corner across from La Cuesta. And I have some understanding about what that involves, but just because it is a very open and notorious demonstration that has been going on now for some period of time, if maybe you could talk a little bit about that so everybody understands what's going on with that. If you know.
I have to apologize, although I've observed it, and I believe it relates to work they're commissioning related to the overall improvements they've proposed through their application of the Planning Commission. We haven't specifically gotten involved in that labor dispute, so I'm at a loss to give you details.
Okay.
Okay, there are no other comments for tonight. Now's the time for public comment period. Anyone in the audience who would like to address the council on a matter that is not on our agenda tonight, but within our jurisdiction, please feel free to step up to the podium. Yes, please.
Good evening. David Lesnini, 99 Piedmont Court. As I sat here listening to your recognition for Chief Sinnott, it occurred to me that it might be an opportunity to combine the departments just as you successfully have combined the police departments. So I was pleased to hear the city manager's report, and I encourage you to investigate that further. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Would anyone else like to make a comment to the council tonight on something not on the agenda? Okay, seeing none others, we can now move into the first business item. The first business item is actually an item 3.8 from the consent calendar, and it is on the proposed retainer with the Grove Consulting Group. I don't remember what their full name is, but that's for facilitator's role in our community facility and library parcel.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Very briefly, you'll recall at your last agenda item on the schematic design process for the community facility parcel, the council gave direction to the staff that you would like to conduct a series of town hall meetings. I think you specifically said three town hall meetings that you'd like held so that the community could come together and provide input. And in particular, there was discussion and direction from the council about addressing this question of what is the look and feel that defines Larkspur that would be appropriate to the project. And I think Councilmember Hilmer had talked about sort of creating some design directions, so to speak, for the project. You had asked that we find you a facilitator and keep the process moving, and that we try to have the first town hall meeting toward the end of June and beginning of July. Unfortunately, staff wasn't able to meet the council's direction to try to have a town hall meeting then, because it took us a little longer than we anticipated to vet options for a facilitator. That we wanted to find a facilitator that we were comfortable had a track record in dealing with a wide breadth of issues, and that might bring an approach that would be helpful to building consensus discussion at the town hall meetings. We ultimately had a chance to meet the principal people that we identified here in the report from the Grove, a firm that specializes pretty much entirely in facilitation. We were very impressed with them. They came highly recommended. They specialize in facilitation. They bring people to consensus in all sorts of different types of projects and all levels of consensus or agreement at the beginning of those projects. They have experience somewhat in areas like this of design and public projects, but it's by no means the only thing that they do. And in some respects, we found that very attractive because we felt the goal here was to build consensus around community voice and to have a firm that had that as their emphasis. This particular firm utilizes a type of graphic visualization technique that several of your staff people and I think some of the council members have experienced in consensus building workshops and in consensus building forums. And what they essentially do is they record in a combination of words and graphics what's being said all throughout the meeting up on poster boards or butcher board all around the room, so that everybody can constantly be looking and referring and see that and see what they're recording as what's going on at the meeting. For a lot of folks who are visual learners, it's a particularly powerful way to record a meeting. I've seen it personally used to build consensus around some pretty significant planning processes. I wasn't present here. I understand TAM has not only used the Grove, but has used other firms that specialize in this particular technique. So we were impressed by all of that. The Grove's a very popular firm. And so they said to us that there was some urgency to getting on their calendar, given we had said to them we were supposed to be having town hall meetings in June. And then the other challenge is I had initially hoped that this contract would fall under my spending authority, and I want to make sure that we build room into this contract, that should the process play out in a way that we need a little more capacity financially, that we have it. My contract authority stops at $30,000. I think this contract should be negotiated somewhere between 30 and 40 in terms of not to exceed. That doesn't mean we're going to spend that much money. As you know, we often negotiate not to exceed amounts, and then we try to maintain the amounts lower than that. To get this on your agenda, particularly given you're dark at the beginning of August, I couldn't negotiate a scope of work with the firm and get it on the agenda. So every once in a while this happens to us. It's unusual, but we come to you and we ask you to grant me the spending authority in excess of my normal authority. And that's what we're doing with this item. And so we are recommending this facilitator. If this had fallen under my spending authority, we probably have just retained them. We brought this item to request that additional spending authority.
Okay, just for additional clarification for both the council and members of the audience and anyone watching at home, if when you go through the contract, can you just clarify the scope? You know, what is it going to be, or if you're not quite sure, what is it not?
For a scope like this, we have a standard template for a professional services agreement that our law firm's already vetted, so as long as we stay within that, we can execute the contract rather quickly. And typically on a professional services agreement like this, the scope is more about the whether they charge us by the hour or by the occurrence of whatever event they're facilitating. So the scope's really going to be how much are we going to pay for each town hall meeting, how much are we paying for the prep time, and how much are we paying for any follow-up time. This type of contract would not get into a lot of specificity. I hope I got that enunciated correctly. About how they go about doing their business of facilitating the meeting. We don't normally negotiate that at the staff level. So this would be much more about price for having these events happen.
Okay, give council the opportunity to also ask our city manager some questions before we take comments and questions from the audience. We'll start with Councilmember Morrison.
Thank you. Dan, we have down September the 2nd, but that's not going to be the date now. Is that correct? We're going to change that date?
If that's of interest to the council, I was made aware that you might want to discuss an alternate date, so we can propose an alternate date. That's the date that is your council meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And so for the convenience of it being a council meeting that I know all five of you would be there,
mm-hmm.
We picked that date. It was a date available on the Groves calendar.
Right.
So that's
but
a
will
nice
families be in town is my concern.
Again, if that's something the council wants to discuss, I can we have some alternatives. You know, it's your decision.
Labor Day weekend. Yeah, but still I'd rather wait to I had one more question, but I'll come back to it. Thanks, Dan.
Hey, anyone else have any questions or comments for the city manager at this point?
Go ahead. Go ahead. No, that's all right.
When we do have these meetings, will the architects be involved?
Well, as you know from all my past comments, I don't think this is a very good process if the architects aren't there listening. They are not facilitating the meeting. They are not. The purpose of the meeting is not to have them engage the public initially. I think if the participants in the meeting want their constructive input, they're not going to sit there and not offer it, but they understand they're there to observe and hear and listen what the community has to say.
Okay, and then Dan, with each meeting, if we have three or four, how are they going to combine the meetings so those that aren't able to show up for one, we can kind of keep them updated? How does that work?
Well, you know, I'm so focused on what the point of this agenda item was, the contract issue. I didn't say that we actually had the opportunity for the two council members to sit on the advisory committee to meet the Grove last week. And while you were both present, and now for disclosure to the council, we did discuss the fact that we've had all our meetings at 6:30, and we asked the Grove, are you available if we want to have some of the meetings during the day? And they said, certainly, as long as they can schedule it. And so I think one of the things we'd like to do is explore whether having some of these meetings at different times of the day and maybe on a weekend or whenever would make it more available to the general public. So I think the first meeting we would probably still do in the evening, but I think some of the subsequent ones could be at different times and different locations.
What I mean with the information from one meeting to the next, they're going to always keep the first meeting, second meeting, third meeting, we're going to always have a discussion of what was said at the last meeting and bring it to the second.
Yeah, so one of the things that's great about graphic visualization as a tool to record is it can then be transcribed into a representation in something online or in a book. And so that's part of what we'd be paying for. And then that conversation can then carry forward. And even someone who wasn't able to attend will have that to refer back to, because they'll then put it into a book with some additional text notes so that people can understand what took place. Is that
That's exactly. And we're going to also put on the website, too?
It'll be available to everybody.
Yeah. Thanks, Dan.
So, Dan, the Grove to facilitate conversations about look and feel, character, sort of helping us define what is the Larkspur look, from what I understand. But this isn't about design as far as redoing the design in process so far. I just want to clarify that. And I took the time to go back. Well, you can tell me if I'm correct with that. But I took the time to go back and look at the May 22nd video and the June 3rd video. And from my understanding of what all five of us said is that we remain committed to LMS as our architecture firm, that this is to enhance our understanding and community's consensus, but not to replace LMS. Is that right?
That's the direction I heard, yes.
I looked back on that to make sure we were all consistent with that, and I think that's very important that we continue to show our support for the process that we've engaged in so far. I would love to echo that. And looking back on that videotape and seeing that we had actually asked, hopefully, to start in July, I would like to get this started as soon as possible. So I am very much interested in keeping the September 2nd date. So if we're going to discuss dates, it is a council night, so we would be giving that up, but we would all be available to participate. And I also would really, when we negotiate this contract, love to see two daytime meetings, if possible, in which we can reach out to families and children, young children and their families to come and be participating in this, because 7:15 doesn't work for a lot of families. But I that's it for now, but I just wanted to put those things out there that about LMS and how we remain committed to that process.
Kate, any other questions for now? No, okay. If not, I'll just invite members of the public up if they would like to ask staff or council any questions or to provide whatever comments you'd like to on this item. Yes, please.
Hello, I've been here many times, so you know me, Teresa Rose.
Thank you. We just need to get it on the tape.
I'm not sure if this is working. I have looked at the Grove website. I didn't really see anything on there that showed that they were going to be able to give us anything but whiteboard, and I'm not sure exactly what they would be doing. I like Phil Terry's idea of a moderator rather than a facilitator. But I also think that in order to understand the look and feel of Larkspur, all anyone has to do is walk between the Lark Creek and the Blue Rock. We know what it is. It's Victorian. And I don't think that LMS Architects understands that. I think that the process should have stopped when you could not find an architect that wanted to do anything but contemporary design. That's just not Larkspur. I think that we need to find an architect that will make it look like our street now. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Hello, Susan Schmidt, 58 Piedmont Road. 28-year resident of Larkspur. I thank you for pulling this from the consent agenda so we have an opportunity to ask a few questions before the contract is negotiated. It's not clear to me if you are actually tonight approving both the facilitator and the contract in advance of seeing it, or if you're just giving Dan the opportunity to negotiate the contract and bring it back for approval to council. So I appreciate a little clarification on that. I have a few questions if you would at some point consider them and maybe address them. One, in terms of facilitators, I've also been on the website and they look very impressive and they obviously have quite a resume. I have some questions since most of their work seems to be in sort of strategic visioning and development and sort of fairly business-oriented settings, communication, videos and training videos and that sort of thing. I didn't see anything specifically related to developing a community consensus around the look and feel of a building, but I'm not suggesting they aren't capable of that. But so I consequently have a question about what size of groups they are accustomed to facilitating, and if there will be, if the process will include an opportunity for all interested members of the community to come, if there'll be a venue selected that is large enough to accommodate hundreds if they choose to have a voice, and also if there'll be a process and if it will be part of the negotiated contract with this group or something the city will take on to assure that there is widespread enough publicity about the event itself. We have the school marquees, and we have next door, and a number of vehicles that are free to the city. So I don't know who would be responsible for that, but I hope there'll be a good deal of effort. Yeah, are you cutting me off?
No, I was just gonna
stop the time clock.
Wave towards our city manager and see if he can answer some of those questions for you.
Still writing down.
Oh, yeah, that's okay. Well, I can start with
I have a few more.
Sorry.
Some of them have been answered.
Oh, there's more? Do you want me to answer them or wait? I'm sorry.
We can let Susan finish her questions.
Okay, asked some of them for me, so it'll be briefer than I had planned. I'm interested in, you mentioned the scope, but then you said it wouldn't be particularly specific. So I'm curious what the thinking will be about, number one, the specific end goal of these meetings. I've heard look and feel, but if there is some point in the process that the information that you've gathered from input from the community will be given to the architects, and they'll be back with some rough preliminary sketches that will be proof that they, in fact, understand, they get it, and they're now ready to move, in a direction maybe that's completely consistent with the character of Larkspur, however that ends up being defined. So I'm curious if that's part of this phase of this process, or if you will have a subsequent phase after look and feel has been defined that won't include these facilitators but will go to the architects. I appreciate what you said, Catherine, about wanting to respect the process as it has gone so far and your feelings about these architects. But I think at some point, if we aren't getting feedback that from the architects that reflects they really do understand a small town character as opposed to the sort of urban feel. Are you cutting me off? That we'll be open to, that our larger loyalty is to creating the very best project that is consistent with what this community wants and not loyalty to a previous process or an architect. I think we have to keep in mind that's the bigger objective for this very enormous, probably last big civil project in our community. And other than that, I think you asked the other questions that I really wanted to ask. So thanks very much. Appreciate it.
Okay, thank you. I guess if our city manager is still writing, or
I think I have all the questions. If I missed one, I'm sure one of you will tell me.
Okay.
I think the first question is, would the contract come back to the council? That's not our intention. We would execute. You're authorizing me to negotiate the scope and execute the contract. The question was about the Grove's background. The folks at the Grove facilitate everything from corporate board facilitation and consensus building to major group discussions, community discussions. One of the ones closest to us that they did is, since they are located in the Presidio, they got the contract and were involved with facilitating the reuse of the Presidio. And they did quite a bit of the help in terms of facilitating discussions on the reuse of different parts of the Presidio. So they do have that in their background. But again, we're not hiring them. We're not proposing to hire them because they're design people. We're hiring them because their specialty is facilitating communication. Maybe I should quickly expand upon that point. We had a lot of discussion at our staff level, and I had some conversation with other entities that go through this challenge of how to facilitate a meeting. One of the concerns I have about bringing somebody in who's a design professional to act as the facilitator is we really need our entire community, regardless of your breadth of understanding of design, to be able to participate in this process without creating a reaction from the professionals. And I know that I'm guilty at times in my body language and in the things I say of reacting to words that lay people use because they trigger reactions in me. And I know that other professionals sometimes have that. The reason you hire folks who are facilitators of communication, and that's their specialty, is one of their training is not to react, but to improve that everybody's hearing what everybody else is saying, and that everybody's clear what everybody else is saying to one another, and not getting caught up in they used a technical term incorrectly. And so that, for me, a big attraction of hiring a professional facilitator where that's what they do, is that's what they do. That did weigh into my thought process on this recommendation. We intended for staff to take on advertising. That was one of the questions. So we would take on. Another question was, would the venue be large enough? Other than the fact that the hall gym's going to get its floor redone or something, and so Dick Whitley told me I can't necessarily have it every single time till the school's done with it, that would probably be our preferred venue in terms of accommodating large crowds. If we can't use that one, we'll look for another one. We've also thought maybe one of these sessions should occur in Greenbrae, so we may look at the community room over in Greenbrae next to Jason's as a possible facility for one of the meetings. Part of the scope will be, I suspect, interviews with the five of you, since hearing what your direction actually meant really will drive what the preferred outcome is. So one of the questions that I heard was, what's the preferred outcome? And we heard your direction on tape. The Grove people have listened to that. They know what you said. But I suspect the first part of the scope will be to interview each of you to make sure they understand what the five of you are trying to get out of this. Because through me, you're the client of this process. Because your desire is to hear from the community and your desire is for this facilitator to help you help the community build consensus on a voice to you. In info, the architect, well, we intend to have the architect present and listening. So not only will they get the info afterwards, but they'll hear the conversations while they're taking place. I think I got them all. Did I miss any of them?
I think there was one more regarding phase three, or the next. What is there thoughts about what the next phase would be after this?
I haven't watched the tape from your last meeting in a while, but I think you left that to be decided. Sorry, I'm having trouble with my voice tonight. I think you left that to be decided after you see how this process goes.
Yeah, we have Councilmember Hilmer, then Councilmember Morrison.
I just wanted to add a comment relative to, I guess, going back to the question about what happens after the town hall meetings take place and there's an outcome from those meetings. What happens with that? And you also mentioned that we are the city council is the client for the project. So my hope is that as client for the project, that after the town hall meetings take place and the outcome is developed representing what took place at the meetings, that the city council then takes ownership of that and clarifies design and any other direction necessary for the purposes of directing the architects, so that there isn't kind of a guess as to whether the architects are going to implement from the outcomes of the meeting. I think that's the client's responsibility to be clear in communicating the direction given to the consulting team. And just speaking for myself as an architect with 30 years of experience here in Larkspur, I'm confident the council can develop clear direction reflecting the community consensus. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
I want to go to the public outreach. So Susan, yes, next door, marquees of the school. We also reach out to the school, to the families within the schools. We're also going to, as you see, a fence is going to be going on the LLCC around the perimeters, and we're going to put up a big sign announcing when the meeting's going to be held right on Doherty, so that's going to help. I personally am going to probably make up my own flyers and hand them out in neighborhoods with some neighborhood kids, so we're going to really reach out to a lot of families, especially younger families. Yeah, thank you.
Anything?
No. Just real quick, I think it's a terrific idea to proceed with this, and I hope we vote to do it. I do want to echo the comment that you made about the desirability of maybe having a meeting over in Greenbrae. In part, not just because to break up where we're doing these meetings, but to really engage that part of the community, and the fact that all of the kids who live over in Greenbrae go to Kentfield schools, at least at the elementary and the middle school level. So I think it's important, to the extent that we're reaching out to the schools, that we make sure that we, you know, expand our scope to include the entire community of school age kids who may be taking advantage of what we're doing here. And just, you know, finally, I just want to echo what Dan said about, you know, translating the feedback or the input that we get from this process to the architects. I agree that that's our responsibility to manage. And I think it's important for the art, but I also think it's important for the architects to be there and to hear directly what people are saying, so that we can all have kind of a shared understanding about the outcome of those discussions and agree that the direction that we are providing is appropriate under the circumstances.
Okay, thank you. All right, who would like to come up next and speak? That's.
Hi, I'm Mary Clyde. I live a Larkspur resident. First of all, I'd like to ask the question Susan didn't get answered in the last conversation that you guys were trying while you were writing down. Will the community have an opportunity to see preliminary sketches before LMS is given direction to proceed, if LMS is chosen as the final architect after the discussions? Do we know that?
Or do you have a list of questions? Or
well, this is part of one of my questions. My question primarily is, I spent a lot of time looking at the Grove website, and I was impressed by what they do. Mm-hmm. My question is how do they fit into the process? And we've touched on it with other people, but I was part of the master planning committee, and I'm like, we came up with a lot of direction in that, you know, 6 months that we worked together. And I was wondering, how are they going to accumulate what that group did and then bring it forward? Or is that like scrapped and we're starting from the beginning? It's just, it's going to be, to me, it's kind of confusing how they're fitting into the process. And then after they finish, if we come up with, you know, a mural of images and impressions and ideas and lists from the community that kind of start to, you know, formalize, how does that process move forward? And I just, you know, it'd be nice just to see how the community is going to fit into the entire process, and also not be wasting money when we've done a good deal of work with the master planning. And I heard from Dan Schwartz that they were confused by some of the results from the notebook put together for master planning. I don't think there was enough people on the advisory committee from the master planning committee to actually help translate some of the gray areas. And so I'm just trying to like kind of understand the whole process and make sure we're not like jerking around, and, you know, we just kind of get to a point where we spend enough time, we're, you know, going in circles, and we're just going to design this thing. And does this make sense? What I'm saying is, like, it's just not clear to me, and I don't see a real process presented. And also in the notes that I received from Larry, it sounded like we were just kind of rushing, and that just concerns me when we're rushing because we're trying to fit into somebody else's schedule when it's our schedule that's most important.
Okay.
So the question is, yeah. Has this been thought out? Is there a formal process now that we're hiring more people to help us with the process? Is there a place to look at it? I mean, when we did the master planning, they had a, you know, every month this is what we were going to accomplish, we're going to move forward, but I haven't seen anything like that.
Okay. Well, I think we have a process, but I'll let the city manager answer that question. I mean, I tried to describe to you today that this is actually narrower in scope than you're thinking of it, because council walked away from our last two meetings on this topic, and basically the big question was, what does look and feel mean in Larkspur? And we need to have that clarified. So that's mm-hmm. what these three meetings are. Now, how that translates as the next step after that, I think, relies on the outcome of the feedback we get in this process. And, you know, it was just, I thought, fairly well articulated with Councilmember Hilmer just a second ago, is that at that point, you know, the council needs to decide what direction they want to take it. We don't know where we want to take it until we go through these next few meetings, because that's what the public has asked us to do, is to better clarify what look and feel means, despite, you know, say, for example, the LARC committee feeling like they've already been through that.
Well, like, back to this question that Susan was asking to be answered, was when we get to the end of that, you know, we as a community, we still don't know if we're going to be able to participate in seeing the design process evolve at early stages, as opposed to this last time when we had a pretty finished look that we spent $250,000 developing. I mean, is there going to be a process for the community there? Or is that going to go back to an advisory committee?
After the town hall meetings, it's my hope that the council will take ownership of creating the direction to be given to the architects with public comment and public meetings.
Okay, so there will be...
So we won't release it until we're satisfied that it's clear direction that reflects community consensus.
You won't release what? I'm just curious.
Direction to the architects as the client for the project.
But then when the architect starts the process of developing ideas...
Well,
will the
whatever it takes so that the community consensus is reflected and that we hear from the community, yes, you've got it, you understand it. It might mean we produce some images. I won't say what kind, but it might include that plus words.
Well, this is where I'm confused. Is the Grove website didn't show any examples of doing a process building a building, a community building on their website. And it was an extensive website. And so I'm trying to figure out how some little comic images and word lists, you know, become...
Well, we don't know what kind of images are going to be necessary. So to try to characterize them in any way would be unfair.
Yeah, we're not asking them to design the project or facilitate the design. We're asking them to facilitate a discussion about mm-hmm. the look and feel of what that means to whoever decides that they're going to chime in on that.
Okay.
If it's helpful, look at my professional information on the internet. You'll see a good deal of experience in just this sort of translation working for cities outside of Larkspur. So the city manager can answer the questions, but I'm just telling you, we've got everything that we need in order to do what's necessary to direct the architects with these meetings, plus the council's experience. So, city manager.
It might be helpful if I could illustrate for a second. We've had a speaker come to the microphone and said, we don't really need to do all of this because the definition of what Larkspur is within a two-block stretch of the downtown and is a Victorian design. I have a pretty strong feeling that's not universally agreed upon by the residents of Larkspur. I've been doing this just long enough that I
don't know.
So my point is, it didn't take a sketch to have that conversation. And the purpose of hiring the facilitator is to have the conversation where everybody gets to walk in a room and say, my vision of what Larkspur is the home at such and such a location, or my vision of what Larkspur is the architecture that's called this, or my vision is the two block stretch of downtown. And that doesn't require anybody to draw a sketch to have that kind of discussion.
Well, I guess the difference is I'm trying to compare with the last process that we went through, where I think there was a committee that thought they were pretty confident in a design direction and approved a significant amount of work to be done, and it wasn't, you know, widely welcome. So how is this process going to be different is what I'm
I think one thing that's being misrepresented is that the original process was done, Mr. Mayor. The original process hit the 50% mark.
Exactly.
And so it wasn't done. And I don't think anybody had approved anything other than the advisory committee had recommended that a design be presented to the community, and the reaction of the community that attended all our meetings was, we don't like that design. And that's when the council gave direction to me to work on this process so that we could get at these design values. So I don't think it's fair to LMS or the staff to suggest that, or the advisory committee to suggest we presented a final product. But I think if you go back and pull those documents, they're pretty clearly labeled the 50% point. I do think that because of modern technology, what's now presented at the 50% point looks a lot more finished than it did when I started my career 20 years ago. When you were at the 50% point 20 years ago, you had hand-drawn sketches on onion skin paper, as the public works director likes to remind me it's called. And today what we have is computer printouts that look pretty darn close to what we think of as a finished product. But the architect's been really clear that they didn't finish that process.
Well, so. I mean, we spent most of the design budget, maybe is a better way of saying it. So anyway, I guess I'm just trying to compare how is the result going to be different from the last time to this time. So
can I say something, Dan?
Go ahead.
Well, Mary, you mentioned earlier that we're going around in circles, mm-hmm. and we were, so we stopped. And now, as Dan said, we're 50% there. You knew how well the facilitator worked with the LARC committee, right? We all had different ideas, different thoughts, and look what happened with that facilitator. She brought us to a consensus.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm hoping is going to happen this round also. You saw the beauty of it.
Right, but on the website, they talk about, like, ideal group size is, like, 10, and I'm, like, wondering how we're going to do this in a gym.
You know, it'd be great. Can I take you there?
I just,
and we can meet them in person?
No, I am sold on this group, Anne. I am not trying to say I don't want them as facilitators.
I'm not sensing that.
I think they're good. I'm just trying to figure out how are they going to actually accomplish this, and how does that fit into the overall process to get to the end result. Last time, it just, you know, they're going to come up with words and arrows and things like that.
They're
going
to come up with the consensus of the public. That's our goal.
Okay.
That's our goal.
Okay.
Listen to the public. What do they want?
Right.
And try to reach out to a lot more families. That's...
I'm just here trying to bring awareness as to that the community would like to participate in the process.
Absolutely.
And we'd like to feel like the master plan is presented somehow and not repeated again and paid for again through another public process. And I just don't know how that's all being done. I guess it just happens, but it's not clear to me. So, but I think I've raised the question, and at least you're aware of my concern.
Okay. I think at this point, you know, if it requires more clarity and you would like to get a better understanding of it, then maybe we can just set up a meeting with a couple council members. Because I think a lot of the things you're asking for can't be defined. Because if they were, we would have a predisposition to a preferred solution, and that's not what we want here.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Can I bring up, just Mary, in response to some of the comments, I have a lot of professional faith in the skill set that our city staff have, and I think our city manager and our city director of public works and our director of planning are very professional in the way that they assess quality of and skill sets that were needed to complete a job and to do a very good job for this community. And I'm confident that the Grove was well vetted by them, and they will be consistent in making sure that the mission and the interests of the council are represented well with that process. And we will evolve the process as it comes along. And I also really feel important to reiterate that these drawings that have been seen are not the done deal, and that's such misinformation in many ways around the community that we are really only in the 50% phase of this with a lot of more work that can be done. It's very important that people understand that we are really paying conscientious attention to this as the five of us and very much on the same page about how important it is to get this right also.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
My name is Community Consensus, and I live in Larkspur. I'm Phil Terry from 82 Diane Larkspur, and I want to thank Susan and Mary for asking all the tough questions. I want to ask Ann and Catherine for chiming in on some really important issues that I thought capsulized what we need to ask and where we're going. The Heather Gardens had a 4th of July gathering in Heather Gardens Park, and there was over 100 people there, and half of them or more, I didn't see Dan, but he probably had his own party, were children. Okay, that group just kicked in someplace between 46,000 and 51,000 to see an improvement in that park. Those are the active people of the future. They're going to dictate what happens. They need to be contacted, outreached to, and brought in. The kids are not even in school yet. I mean, it's a zoo over there with little kids running around. So your point about reaching out, did that red light go off already? That can't be.
I didn't set it, so okay, I guess you got a freebie there.
Well, anyway, I really, there's some people missing from this conversation, and they are those. The second thing is, I wrote a lot of contracts in my life before the legal people moved in and said, you can't do that. And well, one of the things that were in the contracts I wrote were deliverables. They had to meet certain deliverables, otherwise they didn't get paid. Now, the request for some flexibility in your contract negotiations, I appreciate that. That's smart. However, I want to make sure that you think about those deliverables. Consensus is what we're looking for as a community. And I don't know how you write that into a contract, but you know, I've watched you, Dan. You're very clever. You can move that in there. If we come out with that, we'll all be satisfied with the money spent. If we're not going to be satisfied with that money spent and not getting what we need, then perhaps one of the brave city council members would like to take the crack at the September 2nd just to outline what we intend to do as a community going forward with this group that's has this ability for the amazing images to bring everybody together. That would save us $40,000 if they were willing to work through the consensus process on their own. However, I mean, they're not exactly hired to do that. You're not hired at all. Well, maybe. Anyway, they're not there to provide that kind of service. It's a specialized capability. But if they wanted to take a crack at initially setting forth the goals of what we're trying to do with this group, that might get a lot of it out on the table, get a lot of that vitriol or whatever it's out there, or that, I mean, you might just get clapping consensus and move on. However, that would be a goal. Deliverables in the contract, and perhaps rethink how you want to initiate this. I'm concerned about the people coming back from Europe and Hawaii and every, you know, I'm jealous, but I'm concerned that they won't be there on September 2nd. So that's, and I think you brought that up. The other thing too is the look and feel of Larkspur, I've had people say, well, what is it? And I'm saying, I don't know. The two blocks are good enough for me, but I'm looking at Rose Lane now. That looks like maybe that's the next effort, and that does not look like the design I've seen. So I've also been to Hooper, Nebraska, and I've been to Route 66, and I've seen places where it dies. And the 1950s architecture with that flat-top roof and slanting thing, it's good for gas stations in the 50s. But we need something that's modern and chic but up-to-date and has a little bit more contemporary style, what you can look back on and feel proud of. I mean, the Carnegie libraries are still standing, and they're beautiful entombments for tombs. No, what's that word? Big books. There we go. I'm illiterate in some regards. Anyway, I I wish you all the best in this, and I know you're going to bring it back, and I know the process. Mary's really on it because the process is kind of murky, and I think you're all kind of trying to figure out how that's going to work too, because how do you bring everybody together and get them to say, okay, let's go forward and let's do this, and then still build something we all can be proud of, you know? Is that enough? Anyway, good luck.
Great, thank you. Yes.
And thanks for letting us do this early. Thank you.
Before you come up, let me see if anybody else wants to speak first so they have an opportunity. On this library community center item, before Susan comes back up, anyone else like to comment or ask questions? Yes, Anne.
I just wanted to address one of Phil's comments really briefly. Yeah. The challenge with this assignment is that really the deliverable is that the council satisfied that you heard what you need to hear from the community. So that's why we'll have to write the scope to have the flexibility. And that's why I mentioned I wanted some additional spending authority. It's because I want to make sure when we get through three meetings and I check in with you and you say, well, I'm happy, or could we follow up and kind of dig a little deeper at this or that, that I have some flexibility with the consultants to do that. Because that's the deliverable, that you have what you need to do what Councilmember Hilmer's saying, which is then give direction to the architect.
Good, thank you. Okay, yeah. No, because it's being recorded, so we need to get it on the microphone.
Just wanted to, Susan Schmidt again from Piedmont Road. I just wanted to ask that going forward, because this is such an important project in our community and of interest to so many people in the community and growing, I hope, as they become more aware of it, that all future discussions, whether it's presentations by staff or agenda items, not be on the consent calendar and be very clearly identified in the agenda as addressing something related to the Library Community Center facility.
Okay, thank you. With other projects like this, we've also placed them on the agenda as a business item just in case there was an update. At least it was already on the agenda, but we didn't necessarily have to talk about anything if there was nothing to report. So we can follow in that tradition as well. Okay, any more comments or questions from the audience on Library Community Center, at least the facilitator for it? Okay, seeing none at this time, I'll bring it back to council and see if they have any questions or comments for Dan or Mary Grace before we give them direction, and also we have an action in front of us.
I would just like to reiterate, when we do set the time and the dates for these, that we continue to encourage, that we continue to look at dates that are during the day, either 9 o'clock in the morning or 1:30, at least one of them, so that we can have opportunities for attendance by our young families. So really think that's important.
Okay, yes.
I'm happy to make a motion.
I think one of the things we also still have as an outstanding question is whether we want to keep it on the second. You were going to suggest that there might be alternative dates.
The Grove did indicate to us that they could facilitate some other dates in September. There are some challenges with other activities of your staff and the council. The only alternative date that really jumped out as a good possibility given the breadth of the calendar was September 8th. But Tuesday, I didn't have a chance to see if you have conflicts with other boards and commissions and meetings that you attend, and I usually take more time to do that.
Can we find out, Dan, when Hall goes back to school, when Kent goes back to school, when is back to school nights?
It's August.
It's all in August?
No.
No, see.
I believe the Larkspur School District goes back on the 8th, I think.
And I think there's back. Yeah, I think so too, Susan. Thank you.
Yes.
Go ahead, Dan.
Mr. Mayor, I think there's something to be said, if possible, that we hold these meetings consistent with our council meeting dates. I just think there's something, it's likely the best we can do given all the competing schedules and everything to give some dependable pattern to these meetings, and I think our city council regularly scheduled meetings offer that pattern.
Well, to echo that, one of the reasons we landed on that date early is because when we looked with the calendars, we always know that council meeting days are the days you five keep clear. So echoing your comments, I think it's critical that these meetings be available to you. Mm-hmm. And I'm concerned about moving it off that date for that reason. I think even when we look at the mornings, we may target a weekday morning, we may still target a council meeting day, because those tend to just be days that I know that five of you keep relatively clear.
How about the 16th?
It's too late.
Well, no, this is, again, the Grove couldn't facilitate every opportunity, so
they're not
the 8th really was the only other September opportunity. So. And there will be more meetings.
I want people to come.
But we, yeah.
I'm open on the 2nd. I just want as much people to come as possible, and if they're gone.
Mr. Mayor, if I stop and think, I could probably find a reason not to do it on any day of the year. But I think it's September, regularly scheduled council meeting dates. I think that's a dependable pattern for us to begin this. And it's a series, it'll be a series of meetings. This is not the first mm-hmm. and last. I just think that's probably a balanced
I agree.
Decision.
Okay. You said you agree. Councilmember Haroff was going to make a motion.
If we're ready for that.
Yeah. Did you have any other comments?
Nope.
Okay.
I'd like to move that the council adopt resolution number 65/15, authorizing the city manager to retain Grove Consultants International for town hall meetings for the community facility parcel project.
Okay, we have a motion. Can I have a second?
I'll second that.
Motion and second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay, thank you everyone for attending this. If you are only interested in the library portion, we still have a couple other business items to discuss tonight. Give it 30 seconds or a minute for people to clear the room if they're not interested in this part of the discussion. I didn't see you hiding in the back there, Neil. Okay. Oh, hey Tom, didn't see you there. Okay, yeah, looks like Captain Shirk is gone. That's okay, we didn't have to keep him here in the audience tonight. Chief.
No,
oh no, Shirk. That's Chief Search. I'm thinking
don't
Captain
confuse
Shirk.
You got that one right this time.
Yeah, I got it right. now you got me questioning myself. Okay, all right. The next item on our agenda tonight is a review and authorization of a response to the Marin County Grand Jury regarding the what they call COIN, which is a civic openness in negotiations ordinance. And Grand Jury's report was titled The Need for Labor Negotiation Transparency.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. First off, on the dais and now at the back table, I proposed some changes to what I put in the agenda packet that I've provided to you in legislative notation, and I'll address in a little bit why I proposed some tweaks since I issued the agenda packet. So this item is for the council to take up the matter of its charge from the grand jury to respond to its report on COIN, civic openness in negotiations. This is always an interesting process when the grand jury reports come out because your staff assists you with creating a draft, but it's your draft. It's your response to the grand jury. It's not staff's response. So we hand off to you that rough draft, and then you get to decide if it's satisfactory, if you want to edit it further. Some years our responses are pretty simple, and some years our responses are rather detailed. This year, is a more detailed response than I've provided to a grand jury report, and that's for several reasons. First off, we're going first, so we didn't have somebody else's letter to point to and say what they said. And one of the reasons we're going first is probably my own personal interest in this topic, some of the council members' interest in this topic, and the fact that we're going to be dark in August for the first meeting. So I wanted to give you this opportunity to discuss the letter and decide if it's satisfactory or if you want it to come back, because this will give you the time to do that if that's how you so choose. the grand jury has identified as a topic the issue of transparency in government, and that is a timely topic that's being discussed in a number of the ways that we do business. This particular subject has to do with the disclosure of negotiations with labor organizations, and COIN in particular, which is a very specific approach to transparency in government that has emerged in the last few years out of California, out of Southern California, and has begun to gain interest in cities around the state. And so Marin County, I think, is one of many areas where these discussions will be happening over the next year or two as people become more aware of this idea and how it might fit or not fit in their own community. So COIN essentially prescribes a series of steps in how a city council could disclose information related to its negotiations during a particular labor bargaining session that it's having with, or bargaining process that it's having with one of its represented groups. In Larkspur, you have two represented groups. You have your firefighters are a represented group, and then your miscellaneous employees are the other group. And that's essentially all non-sworn, non-management employees are in the miscellaneous association. So our experiences are specific to how we deal with those two particular groups. In helping to prepare this draft, I realized it's difficult sometimes to remind myself how the general rules work and then how we put those into practice in Larkspur. And in rereading the letter and getting some feedback from a couple of folks, particularly with respect to some issues about when you trigger issues of bad faith bargaining, I realized I had gotten a little too caught up in the way Larkspur has done it, and I needed to be more clear with the grand jury and the public that my comments are somewhat specific to Larkspur. And that's because, in general, I would say, in my experience, the Larkspur Council is tremendously active in its negotiation process and has always tried to act as strong fiduciary officers for the city in negotiating with its groups. And so, as a result, all throughout the bargaining process, you're constantly requesting and being given updates by your lead negotiators and your staff about the ramifications of what's being talked about at the table. And there's no tentative agreements that are entered into in Larkspur on the city's behalf that you haven't essentially authorized. And I realized after taking a step back, that's not the case in some large organizations where direction to negotiators is rather broad, and then they work out the entire deal and bring it back. So I tried to clarify with the edits that you'll see in here that that particular section and comment was specific to Larkspur in a lot of respects.
So, before you go on, is there copies of this?
We just put some on the back table.
Okay. So for people in the audience, this, the change looks like it's on the first large paragraph on page 3, and it's got underlines to show where the changes have been made.
I think the same points reiterated in a shorter form, two pages back after that. So.
Yeah, middle of page 4.
Page 4, correct. Thank you, yeah. So with that said, we've had the letter out in circulation for you to read. I've tried to provide some additional background. I think the grand jury did an excellent job of explaining to you how the COIN process is outlined and how it works. What I did feel was there wasn't a lot of local context to what they had presented in their report. And so I wanted to make sure that in preparing a response for you, I offered you paragraphs that explain some local context. The other issue that I felt was a bit absent is the discussion of how widespread the use of COIN is or is not. And I felt probably in the grand jury's desire to get this report out, and recognizing that they have limited time, just like all of us, they probably hadn't had the chance to really research how much it's been used. And it, although it is now, right now, there are tables opening up in several of the cities they've identified, it hasn't been used to bring agreements to fruition a whole lot yet. And so the track record of COIN is still relatively new, and the labor relations implications and the legal implications of the COIN process, I think, are still uncertain. And so one of the things I've attempted to help you express in this letter is that there are a lot of uncertainties about this process. And perhaps for an organization where our labor relations are very good and where you've demonstrated fiduciary responsibility and where you already do quite a few of the practices that are outlined in COIN, specifically that you disclose your long-term liabilities related to employment practices, and you provide those reports to the public, that perhaps simply saying we can tighten up a few things, but we're going to take a wait and see on a couple of the key points and see how they play out in some of these agencies that have already adopted COIN is probably the best approach for Larkspur. And frankly, very consistent with the direction you've taken on a number of activities in the past. I think the Larkspur Council's always sort of expressed we're interested in what other agencies are doing and we want to sort of see the results so we can make sure it's right for us. And that's the theme I tried to capture at the end of the letter. This is probably a little more informative of a letter back to the grand jury than I typically write, and I probably should acknowledge that I'd be going first among my peers to help one of the city councils respond. I felt I should help get some more of this information out for public consumption.
Okay, and just as a matter of clarification, this response does not lock us into not doing COIN or doing COIN. It's simply our current snapshot of our responses to the grand jury and, you know, as you've suggested, at some point when we get more information that we can come back and actually have a specific discussion, whether it be about COIN specifically or to provide other guidelines in addition to what we currently do.
I tried to weave in this letter, and I hope it's apparent that I think you're leaving the door open to adopt COIN in this form or some other form down the road. You just want to see how its application is actually playing out in some of the communities that have already adopted these ordinances. The other thing I should make clear probably is the grand jury has suggested a deadline for all of the Marin cities, which is the in 2016 in June, that everybody would adopt this, or sooner if you're bargaining. We don't happen to be bargaining before then. That'll be a little challenging if you take a wait and see approach, because really it looks like to me you won't have 5 to 10 examples of COIN in action until the end of 2016, if not sometime into 2017. So I tried to respond in here somewhere. I think it says, I think that's when you would have a body of evidence that you could take a look at. That's a little awkward only because there's a form that the grand jury gives you and they say you have to explain why what you need to report back to them in 6 months with your determinations of what you're going to do. But in this case, that's not really an appropriate request. And I just want to point that out. There's just sort of a sequencing issue here. But I think come 2017, all of the state will have several tables where that have closed, hopefully, where we can look and see what's happened at those bargaining tables with this process.
Well, as it's been suggested in one of the responses, you know, there are areas in which we can make improvements, and we can do that without having to adopt an ordinance if there hasn't been adequate, let's just say, cases to be able to compare, at least in the spirit of having greater transparency, we can still implement.
Yeah, for example, I think actually one of the best suggestion in COIN is that there be one comprehensive report that brings all the information from these other reports together. It's essentially saying help the public by taking this dense material and combining it into one table. Where I had said maybe we have a difference of opinion is I don't think we need an independent auditor to write a report. It's a summary of independently audited information that we already have. I suspect Costa Mesa or Orange County or one of these agencies, because they're larger, particularly a county, they may not independently audit all of this information. Some of it they may audit internally, and there may have been a desire on the part of the people who wrote this language to ensure that some independent third party had looked at all of this information. That's not the case for Larkspur, and I doubt it's the case for any small city. I suspect all small cities have to go get their OPEB liability independently audited. We have to go get actuarial calculations of what our retiree medical costs are. We have to rely, in our case, on CalPERS actuarial estimates of what our pension liability is. We just don't have the in-house capacity to do that. We do have the in-house capacity to understand those reports and then put them into a synopsis table for you. I think that's a great suggestion, actually.
Okay. Other council members may have some questions, too. I guess start Councilmember Morrison and then Hilmer.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Down the side.
Dan, as we talked about this afternoon, for the public to have input and for transparency for the public, it has to be prior.
Well, I wanted to say that I wanted to clarify, and I hope the language made this clear in the letter. To me, the goal, if I were working on a coin ordinance, is to have a dynamic exchange between the public and the council about the fiduciary issues around labor negotiations. Given the constraints of the way the labor bargaining process is, particularly with closed sessions being part of that process, I have some reservations about what a council can and can't do in terms of engaging the public once bargaining started. But I think the start of the coin proposal is you publicly produce this report and you submit it to the council and has all this information. That's just a council meeting agenda item. I think it's a wonderful opportunity for anybody who's interested in this topic to come to the council, to ask you questions, to express their opinion, and for you to respond in a dynamic fashion if you so choose. So my point in the letter was to say that's a one opportunity, in my opinion, in the coin ordinances that I think there's absolutely no legal risk at all. There's absolutely no labor relations risk to the council to engage in that process. You won't feel constrained. You won't have to be asking Mr. Woodruff, can we answer that question? Can we talk to this constituent? You won't have to have your labor negotiator here raising a red flag because you haven't opened bargaining at that point. You're just discussing conditions as they exist.
And we can implement that next time, correct?
Yes, I think that's a great suggestion, actually. That, to me, is the best suggestion of the COIN process is to add that to the beginning.
Only to say I wanted to hear from the public. I know it's a business item, so it's not a public hearing, but I'd be interested before I make any comments.
Okay, just leaving it open for council members to ask staff any questions before we open up to the public.
No, I don't have questions. I kind of share what Dan just said. I have some perspectives that I'd like to share, but I'd like to hear from the public as well.
Okay, thank you. Would anyone in the audience like to come up and address the council, make comments, or ask questions?
My name's Tom Bradner. Yes, of course, I live here. And it's nice to see you all in with something other than my Mosquito District hat on. Although these issues, of course, are going to affect the Mosquito District before too long. What COIN is, I think, I've been considering how significant it is in terms of fair and transparent display of labor costs in for the Mosquito District. But that's a different issue. Here, the only thing I want to say first that I think your response is very well crafted. It's written clearly, and it's written with an intent to respond, which I think is all too often not missing from most responses that go to the grand jury. You know, usually they check a box that says, don't agree, and that's about the extent of it. The one thing I have concern about is the statement, let's take a look at the top of page 2. It would be the third sentence, which begins with, in addition, Larkspur already commissions 3 third-party audits of the liabilities associated with its employment costs, specifically pension costs and retiree medical costs. And of course you do. Every couple of years, I don't know how frequently you have to have a new audit. I think with the district, it's every 2 years. Maybe it's every year. These are done in cooperation with and through MSARA or CalPERS, whichever happens to be, I guess you're CalPERS, right? And those are good audits. But, I mean, they're not audits. They're good statements of position with regard to unfunded liabilities and items of this sort. But I think that this response misses the point, both letter and spirit, of what is discussed in COIN and what was the intention of the grand jury. The intention of the grand jury was to develop something like a deal sheet. I remember when BART went through its last negotiations, there was discussion on the news regularly about the deal sheets the board was receiving, or some name similar to that. And basically a deal sheet says, provide a column relative to your MOU for the cost of each MOU item as a base year, say the last year of your existing contract, the one before the new MOU, the new MOU under negotiations, will appear. And then display next to that the incremental costs of each item that has changed within the tentative agreement. You may do this for the life. You may have a column for each of the, if it's a five-year life, for each of the 5 years. Maybe with a summary that shows what the total cost would be in the fifth year. I keep hoping that I'm going to hear that, it's not a question you need to answer, but I keep hoping that I hear that councils and boards of trustees such as mine are receiving those things in negotiations. I know my board isn't. And I don't know whether you do, because if so, it would be something that is appropriate for public release after each of the negotiating sessions. The details of negotiating sessions are no longer encumbered by generally speaking, by confidentiality rules. It's only during the negotiations they are. But if you have a sheet like that, it would be important to at least, under the existing regimen, show it to the public at least after you've taken your vote, at some place in the process, so that the taxpayers, me and you also, have a clear understanding of what the costs of these, what the new costs will be resulting from these labor negotiations. I mean, I also think in terms of the labor negotiations, the county just went through a 3% pay increase, and I know it's 6.5% or something like this for other groups within it. 3% pay increase on, say, $1 million is, what, $30,000 in the first year. But if you extend that through the normal working life of employees, which is one thing that could be done in these discussions, using just standard actuarial assumptions, you know, well, $30,000 increased at 3% a year from now until the time you pass away at 84. That's a lot of money every year. And I'm not suggesting that necessarily be in a deal sheet, but I certainly suggest that the baselines of these things, that the third year reflects a 15% increase. That's a lot of money. And especially since it's coming out of taxpayers' pockets. The information is so important to taxpayers, and we're hearing more about this all the time. We certainly heard about it when we tried to do, quite erroneously, I think, our rating keys for the Mosquito District. People defeated it based upon the fact that this was going for things other than operations. I think it was personally misrepresented. But since it was voted down, that's neither here nor there at this point. The other thing is whether or not these numbers should be prepared by staff. I was reading the Attorney General puts out a number of good little manuals. I think this one happens to have 100 pages in it, and it's on conflict of interest. And there's a very interesting situation that I ran across in there, and I don't know all the legal terms related to it, which basically say city employees may not participate at any level other than providing facts in the negotiations process, in the discussions of them. Now, that's something that I don't know any organization recognizes, but that that statement in there under conflict of interest of employees who benefit by every single change, every single certainly increase in pension contributions, salaries, wages, hours of work, number of days of vacation, whatever you have a conflict of interest, or at least a potential one. And of course, the rules are complicated. It takes reading. By the way, I recommend that and the Brown Act manuals, which also is fairly long, but is something that we all read as people serving the public at least every 3 years to remind ourselves of things we never ever thought about. They're all downloadable. They're all in PDF format at the Attorney General's office. And they're very interesting. Well, I don't know. Maybe because I'm an accountant, I'm sort of don't mind strange stuff. But they're certainly very interesting reading for people who want to get into the details of what's correct in running an organization. But in this issue, these CalPERS audits, just as an abbreviation, that's inexact, are not sufficient. It's the deal sheet. It's what is the cost of every line item on the MOU that increases, or what's the plus for those that are negotiated out? Maybe all of a sudden say, hey, everybody's got 2 weeks, we'll give them 10 days, 8 days. Purely hypothetical, it ain't gonna happen. But the point is there are savings that occur in good arm length negotiations, and they need to be reflected on it. So this deal sheet is basically a paragraph by paragraph, item by item of what's in the MOUs, comparing it to the base year and showing us what the change may be. Okay, I'll go away. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. I saw your hand up. Yeah, please step up podium.
David Lesnini, 99 Piedmont Court. I sent you an email urging you to consider the coin process. I'm very impressed that you were organized enough to keep track of that and notify this meeting. That's very impressive. Secondly, I heard the suggestion that to have a pre-negotiated meeting where the public could express their opinions, and that could well be useful. But I think one part of the coin is to follow through as negotiations proceed, what happens at each step, and the fiscal costs of each proposal. The grand jury's point for after each proposal accepted or rejected by either party to negotiation, the proposal is publicly disclosed, and costs are associated with that. And so that's one thing that I didn't hear that makes coin different from your Ms. Morrison's proposal. And just one final wordsmithing idea. On page 5 of the response, about the middle of the page, as noted previously, the City Council does not believe it would be fiscally prudent. That cause stops me. I suggest it believes it would not be fiscally prudent. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, who's next?
Hi, my name is David Brown. I'm actually from Mill Valley, and the reason I'm here is because this is a countywide issue. And I have a couple of comments about a couple of things that were said. For starters, if I were you guys, I would not pass a coin ordinance right now, and I'm very much in favor of coin, but in light of the litigation in Orange County, I just don't think that would be a smart thing to do. But let's be clear about what that litigation actually is about. It's not about the contents of the coin initiative, it's about whether the county met and negotiated with the unions about putting it in place. There's nothing in there, there's nothing in that lawsuit anyway, that says the provisions of the COIN initiative itself are illegal. Earlier, Dan commented that you guys are an excellent city council and you're intimately involved in the process. And my sense from living, you know, hundreds of miles away in Mill Valley is that this is a really well-run city. But we are, as someone once said, a government of laws and not of men. And imagine a time when you are not the five sitting there and people who are not as involved or, God forbid, venal are sitting in those seats. I think it would be really helpful to have some protections against that. And, you know, that's kind of what the separation of powers and a lot of things in Washington, D.C. are all about, to protect us from venality of public officials, which none of you seem to be, in my opinion. And while Bob hasn't spoken yet, I'm sure he's going to say some things from the letter from the fire unions that you guys received. And one of the things he said in there, which is interesting to me, is that it is a violation of the law for you guys to hire an outside negotiator. That surprised me. It's also something you said you do on a regular basis. So I don't, there's a disconnect here that I don't get. It strikes me as odd that it would be against the law. But in any case, the unions very much want you not to have professional representation in negotiations. They have all the money in the world to hire negotiators, and there's nothing to stop them from doing it. So they would like a world in which, one, you're overmatched professionally at the negotiating table, and two, you're negotiating in the dark, in a dark room away from the public, and the grand jury is taking exactly the other position that they want you to negotiate in the light of day. I very much was glad to hear Dan's corrections about the the mandatory nature of the approval by the city council here, but after the tentative agreement was signed. But I have to say there's one thing in this process that still bothers me, and that is that if you must approve the agreement that has been signed by your negotiator or approved by your negotiator, then any comments the public might have between the time that negotiation is signed and the time you put it on an agenda and share all the financial information with the public are worthless. The public does not have a say in the process at all while it's happening. And any financial information you give them is worthless to them because they can't make a difference in the process. So I would just say that while I wouldn't pass COIN now if I were you, I would very much keep it in mind. It's something that ought to be done. If you can find a legal way to do it, and I'll leave it there. And Tom's comments about the deal sheets was completely new to me, but if deal sheets can be released after various closed sessions to the public, and if they were done in the Bard case, they certainly can be done here, it ought to be done. It's glaringly obvious that it ought to be done. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Can I just ask a question?
Yes.
Clarification. I just want to make sure I understand, because I did look at the revised draft that you circulated this evening, and that one statement that was in the original draft, which I think is what you were reflecting on, is out.
I changed it to, I think what I've put in is more accurate now. Yes.
I think it's more accurate too. Yeah. That was a statement that I found right. Troubling when I read
and
it.
Maybe for the benefit of the folks at home or in the public, I think I had originally suggested you couldn't vote for the agreement period or it'd be an active bargaining bad faith, which was a mistake. But I was projecting our own personal experience in Larkspur without clarifying. So in the new statement, what I've said is, you know, essentially in Larkspur, the issue is we don't do tentative agreements at the table that you haven't told us we can do. So either A, you're going to destroy any confidence in your labor units that you're bargaining with them in a way that they feel is fair, because you'd be voting no at the end of a process where you've been telling your negotiator, don't sign anything we haven't talked about, or two, we've pushed that agreement over on the table, which I do think if you then voted against at the end would potentially expose you to an accusation of bargaining in bad faith because you pushed that particular tentative agreement across. So I try to clarify that in the language. And then I actually like to respond to one of the speakers. I think the legal litmus test of COIN will come when some labor group challenges it on the basis that an MOU was not approved by the governing board. Because I have a feeling these complex issues of who pushed which parts of the agreement across the table will get litigated if a board chooses to reject it. And that's actually what I'm hoping to wait and see if that, I don't wish that upon any agency, I don't wish that upon any labor group, but I think the test of this whole thing comes when somebody somewhere, somebody of a governing, of an agency, some governing body, chooses to reject an MOU before it that's been negotiated through a fair and governed process.
And just for clarification, that issue may not be teed up in the pending litigation, but I gathered from what you had written in the draft response is that you're anticipating some litigation may occur where that issue, in fact, will be at issue.
Well, so in the litigation that's working its way out now, the speaker's correct. That litigation or that it's a complaint to the PERB board, so it's an adjudicated administrative process, is that particular issue did have to do with whether or not the agency, in this case County of Orange, should have done a meet and confer with the labor unit before adopting the ordinance. Now that the PERB ruling, the preliminary ruling now says, yes, you should have done meet and confer, they now have to go back and do meet and confer if they follow the ruling. The meet and confer process is fraught with the potential for the agency and the labor unit to get into disputes that will have to go back to the PERB board, potentially one by one. And it could be a while before they wind it out. Now, maybe not. Maybe the agency and the labor unit agree it's okay to pass an ordinance. I'm guessing that if I worked for the labor leadership in Orange County, I would not be, I'd be more than willing to litigate any dispute I have in that meet and confer process. So that's my concern, that I think we need to see how that all plays out. And I did hear the speaker say we should wait and see how all that should
play. Yeah, and I just wanted to clarify those issues, yeah. and also the fact that you did make an adjustment to a statement that I also found troubling in the initial draft. So
I would like to ask one question, and that is, does the union have the right to ratify the agreement, or is the signature of their negotiator binding on them? Because if it's not, then you have put yourself in a very lopsided situation where they can refuse to ratify an agreement that their negotiator signed, but you effectively cannot. And that's it.
I will only comment how this works in Larkspur. Mm-hmm. So how this works in Larkspur is once the bargaining teams have come to mutual agreement and we have a complete list of tentative agreements, the bargaining unit takes that back to its people for a vote. And we go back to the council and make sure we didn't screw anything up because, as I said, the Larkspur council, by then, got a pretty darn good idea of what's being done at the table. The bargaining unit then endorses the tentative agreement and works with us to make sure the language in the draft MOU reflects everything in the tentative agreement. And then we take the MOU to the council for the public discussion and vote. So as I understand it, and we have one of our labor leaders right, and he can come up if I'm wrong, They vote on the tentative agreement, and then I don't think they actually ever take up a vote on the final MOU because they've worked with us to make sure all that language reflects what they agreed to in the tentative.
In your revised draft, you said that if council rejects the agreement, you are still vulnerable to charges of negotiating in bad faith.
Well, if the council, this is my understanding, if the council pushed some of those tentative agreements across the table, so we were the ones that proposed them. Let's just say, for argument's sake, we used the previous speaker's thing and there's a 3% raise. And let's just say the city put that out on the table. For the council to reject that at the end of the process after they endorsed it being the offer that was on the table is problematic under labor law.
And, oh, I'm sorry. And the question is, would the same apply to the labor union? Would they be vulnerable to charges of negotiating in bad faith if they made a proposal and they failed to ratify it? And I don't want to beat this to infinity. It's sure. not a major issue. But.
In theory, yes. I think that, yes, they would, in theory, be exposed to that. As a practice, you know, at least here in Larkspur, and I think in all of Marin, talking to my colleagues, we don't have that sort of relationship. It would be beyond extraordinary in Larkspur for us to reach that point, because you know, the president of the fire association is here tonight listening, and he and I have our disagreements. And you know what? We talk them out at the table with our negotiators present. And if we feel like we've been bargaining in bad faith, we don't stop to say, you know, we don't hesitate to say, I don't think this is consistent with what you did before. And we work it out. And I can't remember in my 5 years us ever having gone past solving that issue at the table. And I think that's probably true everywhere. Now, I no longer go to the tables as part of the council, and my discussion previously, now it's entirely with an independent negotiator, but I think she continues that practice. And so, yes, in theory, but I think in practice, it just doesn't happen.
As long as it's fair for both sides. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, yes, please step up to the microphone.
Good evening. My name is Bob Breyer, president of the Marin Professional Firefighters. I'm retired from the Southern Marin Fire District. I spent 32 years there, probably 28 to 30. I conducted or participated in negotiations. And I bring that up because it's different in Southern Marin than it is in Larkspur, as it is throughout the county. And I represent the 11 different departments that are out there. And the grand jury report makes these recommendations, and it's like a blanket, go out there, do this in 2016. But they don't seem to take into account that the agencies all have a culture on how they do negotiations. And for them to come out and say, this is what you need to do, I think it doesn't take into account the relationship that you have. One of the things I think that Dan said is, as president of the local, I do represent all the different agencies, and we have that collaborative working together with agencies as large as San Rafael and as small as Marinwood, and we've done that, and we work together. And I know when I talk with our firefighters, we realize, and we got to work with the community to give back to the citizens. We are involved in a lot of different issues in the county, whether it's MDAs or working on the shared services that you've mentioned about Larkspur and Corte Madera, and we work with the consolidation. So we've always stepped forward. Always, I probably shouldn't say, because I'll probably miss something, but my goal as a president and our firefighters is to collaborate with our elected officials and work with our citizens to deliver the best fire and emergency services that we possibly can. With reference to COIN, my letter went out to 46 different agencies. Some, admittedly, I've never gone to their meetings, but many of our fire districts and cities respond to their entities, whether it's Novato City, getting fire service from Novato Fire District, or Southern Marin Fire District providing the service to Sausalito. My point is my letter is general, and everybody does things differently. As you referenced tonight, you use an attorney. We've had other agencies that don't use attorneys. My point is, with the attorneys, I'm not afraid to sit down with an attorney to negotiate. That's been done. And like I said, in my 30 years of firefighting, my point in the letter is each entity is different. You do your internal financials. Some other agencies may do them a little differently. There's a cost that goes with that. That's something that the grand jury doesn't point out. They make these recommendations, but they don't have the same fiduciary responsibility that you do as elected officials. So whether you use attorneys or actuarials, that's up to you, obviously, and many agencies do it. My questions come into regarding COIN is the way it's written, and although it's not a law, but there's some things out there, it makes it read like when we're at the bargaining table and we start putting different cost items across the table on the first day, the 20th day, they make it sound like you got to do an actuarial breakdown of those costs on each one of those, and those change in negotiations, at least my experience in talking with the other firefighters. We may start out with 3% on the table and end up with 2% and maybe some, we'll say, non-cost item. But that whole process, when you're paying that actuarial to be done, I mean, it adds up. And I think the way that most of us do it is, I'm not sure about the deal sheet, but I know most of us identify what 1% is, and you work through that and as you go through the process. Finally, with COIN, as a public employee, I'm aware of, as all of us, that there's transparency. Our wages, our benefits, all that's transparent. What we do as public employees in the council. And I can't think of anybody that's ever on a council gone out of their way to hide something from the public. Now, I know the negotiations, we do the agendas and it's made available to the people that we're negotiating, and usually after the fact is when information will be usually printed in the paper of what the contract might say. Where do you put the public in line during a negotiation process? I think there, with the collective bargaining that we have in place in California, there it kind of restricts some of the areas where you do that. I'm not trying to hide anything from the public. Negotiations is a two-way street, and sharing information and trying to come to something that is agreeable to both sides. I agree when you go through the contract and we come to a tentative agreement and it has to come back to the council for a vote. If you go 7 days after that, you got to give the public input, and if they're able to go in and, you know, express or discuss, how do you weigh that as an elected official who's already voted in to represent, if you will, the feeling of your district? How do you weigh that at your meeting? Whoever shows up, whether it's labor or citizens that want to take away or give away or give more, how do you weigh that as an elected official? And I guess the bottom line is what's fair? I mean, is a cost of living raise fair? I recently read a letter to the editor in Sonoma County where the lady made a point of President Obama giving the military a 1% raise, and the public employees in Santa Rosa area, Sonoma County, got a 3% raise. She was saying that it wasn't fair for the public employees to get the 3% and the soldiers to get 1%. I agree with her. Those soldiers should have got 3% plus or more. But what's fair? So on COIN, I'm not here to say that I'm against it. I just think there's things that need to be worked through there. I think there's going to be some legal challenges. Mr. Brown is correct that the Orange County case that I did cite in there was about the meet and confer. And that was just pointed out that there is a process in adopting the COIN process. I think if you adopt COIN, I think it takes away some of the flexibility that you have, whether you choose to use an attorney or not use an attorney or an actuarial. And then I'm not sure about the public part of it. Again, I'm not trying to hide anything from the public. I think there's a process in there, but where does that fit under the law that we have? So thank you for your time.
Okay, thank you. Would anyone else like to address the council on this matter? Okay, yes. May want to pull the mic down.
Hello, this is Teresa Rose again. I don't disagree with anything you wrote in your letter, Mayor Chip. I think that's fine. I think the county's problem, the grand jury seems to always be having a problem with their pensions and the cost of the pension. So I thought this was just too interesting to pass up. The federal government, which has more money than any state, county, or city, pays its employees about one-third of their salary for a pension, which is much lower than anybody in the county of Marin. My sister will get $25,000 a year when she retires in 3 more years. That is nothing now. What is it going to be in any part of the country 50 years from now. She could potentially live to be 100. What she has to do for that kind of money is take care of mafia bosses and terrorists. She is the only nurse slash guard in the federal prison system. So anybody who is negotiating a salary who works for the county of Marin is extremely lucky. Tell them that if they want that kind of money, they need to earn it. Tell them they're lucky they're not doing that. She had to take care of Loeffner, who shot Gabrielle Giffner in the head. She took care of Elizabeth Smart's kidnapper, and she's probably going to eventually get Whitey Bulger. So if they want to whine about it, tell them to come see me. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Okay. Anyone else like to speak? We almost got everybody in this room. All right. What I'll do now is just to bring back the council, allow them to discuss where they're at on this draft, and also the opportunity to ask any last questions of either our city manager or city attorney on this. Yes, Catherine.
I'd like to compliment you, Dan, about the how comprehensive your information was that you provided to us, because this is a new concept for me and for many of us to try to understand. And I appreciate the detail in which you were able to give us the background material about that, and it was very helpful to me. I think it was very clear to me in the letter, too, that this is directed for what matters to us, which is the governance of Larkspur. And I think the details that you were able to provide in this draft letter with you and Larry really helped clarify at least our response, I believe, to the grand jury that is specific to us. COIN sounds like a very interesting prospect that we will be addressing as the years go on. And I think we are obviously use many of these concepts already. But I realize that, as Mayor Chu said, this does not exclude us from continuing to adopt many of those processes if we choose to. It's very important that I think we all recognize that Larkspur has a non-adversarial relationship with our employees, and we don't have a lot of them. We only have two unions, but have a very working close relationship, recognizing still that the future may hold a different type of relationship, and that it's very important that we keep that in perspective. So all of these comments were very well addressed tonight. I appreciate that. I think the letter looks good the way it is. I appreciate these new drafts changes that you made in here. It makes more clarity. I'm comfortable with this letter if we're going to submit that.
Okay, thank you. Kevin, would you like to go next?
I also, you know, very much appreciate the work that went into the letter, and I appreciate the clarifications that were made to some aspects of the letter as it was originally drafted that did cause me some concern. I think I probably would have preferred a letter that was maybe less of an attempt to be helpful to some of other communities and more focused on what I do think are our practices and the way in which the grand jury report, as I read it, which does have a very kind of one-size-fits-all structure, that really we do some things, important things, like hire an independent labor negotiator. We do some of the things that are already recommended in the COIN. And that was actually the first impression that I had when I read the staff report as well as your response. We actually do, as a matter of our own practices here in Larkspur, do some of the things that the COIN recommendations would envision, and I think we should congratulate you and congratulate our staff for having implemented those things on our own. I would like actually to have a little bit more time with the letter, just to kind of go through some of the language. There are still, just because you did make an attempt to be very descriptive and explanatory and helpful to some other communities. I worry a little bit that with that, there may be, just in the words and the language that are used, a potential to suggest that we're drawing legal conclusions that we may not want to be doing. So if it were up to me, I'd like to take a little bit more time with the response, maybe even take advantage of the fact that some of our other communities may be writing letters and we can see what they have to say as well with respect to their own jurisdictions. That said, for my own personal schedule, since we don't have a meeting on the beginning of August, I'll be out
for other reasons in the next one, that if it's held up for my own personal benefit, I won't be able to consider it until September, and I don't want to hold up the process just for that reason. So if we do vote on it, I'll probably abstain from the vote just because I do have concerns, mostly with wordsmithing and language, not with content in particular. I do appreciate the changes that were made. I just would like a little more time with it.
Can I offer one response?
Yes, go ahead.
We did have this come up a few years back where it was about the verb, you know, the way the letter was written and not the content. And I think at that time, the council empowered each council member to send their edits to the mayor. And then he compiled them and sent the letter out. And we retained those because that's public record. Just want to be clear of any suggestions you have for language changes. But that is one way you could all collaborate, I think, within the Brown Act, is to just send to Mayor Chu. I don't have a problem with the substance, but like the speaker said, I prefer that it says, does not believe, says believes, it does not. You know, that's one option. We have to work through the city attorney and make sure we do that correctly. Another option that I've seen done elsewhere is to appoint a subcommittee to tweak the drafting, to usually the mayor and one other council member. So that's another option. Third option is just bring it back at your second meeting in August.
I'm not sure. You're suggesting August, but I thought we had a deadline of 90 days after the issuance.
I think it says in the report. It's the beginning. It's at the end of August, 1st of September, or something like that.
I know it was issued. Oh, okay.
I don't know that we have much cause to apply for our extension, right. But think we actually have time.
We, in the past, you know, as it's been suggested, we've had ways to work around it and get everybody's language in without needing to have a meeting again, as long as nothing substantive has changed.
The response date is September 4, Mr. Mayor. I'm looking at the form now.
Oh, so it's the report.
So you could bring it back in
September 2nd.
Well, that's going to be challenging if that's your public forum, but your August your August 19 meeting, you could finalize the letter then.
Yeah, and that's right. I just won't be here, but if we do have a process that would allow us to provide some input on language, which is just kind of what I was looking for, frankly, that would be perfectly fine with me, and I would then defer to the mayor to respond in accordingly.
So perhaps the cleanest thing, Mr. Mayor, would be to put it on the August agenda, unless a council member objects. And in the meantime, council members could send their edits to me. I'll compile them for you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'd like to hear what council members Hilmer and Morrison would like to say and before we take the next step here.
I'm okay, Mr. Mayor, with what was just proposed.
Okay.
I am too.
Yeah, I would... go along with that. I'd like to get whatever edits in there that Councilmember Haroff feels comfortable with. Unfortunately, if we do wait till the 19th, he won't be able to vote on it, but at least...
I trust you implicitly.
Yeah. I would say the only thing that, you know, we've gone through a lot of this. If there was anything that I was thinking in terms of what we do already, and it was kind of brought up in part by, Mr. Bradner, is... that the council is aware of what the financial consequences of, a proposal are, because that information is worked out and presented to the council. So it's not like we're going in there blind. You know, you've done the analysis and provided, that information to us.
Just to elaborate on one last point. One of the things I just want to make clear: this is what we're talking about here tonight is a response to a grand jury report, mm-hmm. And we need to be responsive to that grand jury report. We are not drafting future policy for the city of Larkspur or anybody else. We may want to do that, and we may want to go through a process where we evaluate what our practices are, and in light of the COIN recommendations or other recommendations that we might want to pay attention to, go through a process that would result in changes to our practice where we feel it's appropriate. We've already talked about some of those tonight. But we are not doing that tonight. What we are doing is talking about a response to a grand jury report, which I think we can do, and maybe defer some discussion on what we ought to do in the future in terms of our own practices to a more appropriate time in the future.
Okay, go ahead.
Thank you, Councilmember Haroff. He took the words right out of my mouth. I also want to express my appreciation to the work of the grand jury, all members of the public who've elevated this conversation to the significance to which is appropriate, and to our any future discussions we may decide to take on where we are relative to our current practices and what we can do to improve them. So in that context, I just want to say I think the letter as currently drafted, the substance of it is very helpful, I think, to the discussion with respect to Larkspur's practices relative to the issue. And I also want to say that I'm hopeful that after all council members submit potential edits and comments, that then rather than just there'll be a compilation of it, as the city manager described, through the mayor. But I'm hopeful that we'll be able to look at all those edits proposed at the next council meeting, where this is an agenda item, and then make a decision about what changes need to be made to the draft, as opposed to just including all the edits.
Okay.
I think that would be more efficient than...
Yes. And yeah, I would agree with that. So at this point, I would just take a motion to continue this until the August 19th meeting, and anybody who has comments or other edits that they'd like to submit them to me, and I will pass them on to our city manager.
Okay. So I'll move that.
All right.
Okay, motion, second.
I'll second it.
Okay, all in favor say aye.
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 Okay, well, I'd like to thank everybody for sitting through that. I know you had to sit through another fairly long discussion also, so thank you for participating in this process. If you're interested, we do have one more business item tonight, and it's on the adoption of the American for Disabilities Act transition plan, which is being presented by our Public Works Director, Mary Grace Houlihan.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Tonight, we are bringing forward our final version of our ADA transition plan update. Approximately a month ago, staff presented the draft plan to council, and it's been up and posted for a public comment. The purpose of this plan is to help the city assess our facilities, assess our programs, and how we serve the disabled community and ensure that we're being fair to all, and coming up and developing a plan for removing what we call barriers, both physical barriers as well as programming barriers. Hopefully everyone's had a chance to review the plan. I know at least Councilmember Way has, and given us her comments. We've also reached out to various agencies like the Marin Center for Independent Living and a variety of other organizations that serve the disabled community for asking for any of their comments. Any comments we did receive have been incorporated into the draft plan. They were fairly minor, and the final plan has been provided for consideration tonight. So in adopting this plan, it's establishing a kind of a roadmap to help staff and the council improve our facilities and our programs. I have Tim Gilbert and Ashley Tomerlin with me tonight from MIG, and they're here to answer any questions you may have regarding how the plan was developed and put together for Larkspur. So with that, that's the company or the consultant who's been assisting us
with the capital plan.
Okay, any questions or comments for Mary Grace Houlihan?
Okay. Just to clarify, all we're being asked to do tonight is to approve a resolution for the self-evaluation and transition plan, right?
We're adopting, yes.
Yeah, we're adopting. We've had substantive presentations on this matter.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Previously, so there's no new information about the plan itself,
right,
for presentation
this
tonight.
This gives us the plan, and then we go into action into implementing it. Following this, MIG will assist staff with some training of our senior staff as well as our administrative staff who works with the public on a day-to-day basis, and how we can improve our processes and programs moving forward.
Okay, if there are no members for us, no comments for staff, would any members of the public like to ask questions or comment on this item? Okay, seeing none, we'll bring it back to council. It looks like Councilmember Hilmer has a question or
Would other council members like to ask questions or make comments or discuss? Otherwise, I'm ready to make a motion to adopt the resolution, Mr. Mayor.
Yes.
I just want to thank you, Mayor Grace, for reaching out to some of the communities and agencies within Larkspur that serve our limited mobility residents and businesses. I really appreciate that, having a father who is significantly disabled. So I also took a lot of time personally reading the plan because I'm very interested in that, and recognize that you did a very comprehensive job on looking at access points, particularly in how members of this community can access the government in which we have in our public spaces. So I really appreciate that. But the reaching out, I think, is a real important thing we need to continue to do. And you're doing a masterful job at that in many different ways. But this one was really, I heard positive comments about that from the Brain Injury Network community.
Okay, so we have resolution 6715 before us.
Acknowledging the good work of staff and our team, I'll move that we adopt resolution number 67/15.
Okay, we have a motion. Second?
Second.
Motion and second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay, thank you to the staff from MIG and to you, Mary Grace, and your staff. This is a really comprehensive report, so thank you. Okay. Last business item has been postponed to our next council meeting, I believe, and we'll just take motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second?
I'll second it.
All right, all in favor say okay. Aye.
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 Okay, thank you. It is now 8:54 p.m. and meeting is adjourned. Thank
this
you.
Is your quickest.